Welcome all to the DCEJ webinar series. Today we are privileged to have with us journalist Prachi Salve of India Spend, which is a non-for-profit news organization that practices a type of data-driven journalism aimed at forging better governance, transparency, and an informed citizenry. Of course, at a time when legacy media seems to be falling apart in the wake of changing economies of media and technology. In this webinar specifically, Prachi will talk about her work and that of her colleagues at India Spend during the ongoing coronavirus pandemic and how this moment of rupture in our everyday has changed the practice of journalism in India. Mr. Salve has vast experience in journalism and policy writing, having earned 2 master's degrees in developmental studies and economics from the University of Sussex, UK and Mumbai University, India, respectively. She has worked with prominent organizations such as the Institute of Development Studies UK, the Young Foundation UK, and Greenpeace India. Prachi, on behalf of the Department of Development Communication Extension and Journalism, Institute of Home Economics, University of Delhi, I welcome you to this forum. It's a pleasure to be both a host and moderator for this talk, and I'm sure our students will have a lot much to discuss and reflect upon after listening to you. The platform is all yours now. Please start.
Hi, my name is Prachi. I'm coming to you from Mumbai at my home. I would like to do a really short presentation before I go on to what India Spend is doing in terms of our COVID coverage. Let me not waste any more time and let's begin with the presentation. Everyone can hear me? Okay.
Yeah.
So
yes, we
can. This is, as I said, it's a bird's eye view of media landscape in India. As we all say, digital dawn is also an age of hope or a window of opportunity. As being a part of India Spend, I have realized this very prominently that we have a very lively digital news media scene where, you know, these are some basic facts. Like, you know, today we have, and again, these are not updated numbers. The numbers are quite higher than this right now. Like, for example, 450
Prachi,
million.
I'm sorry to interject, but the screen is just blank. It's just a, you know, graph kind of a, you know.
Is this visible?
You have shared some screen, but it's just like a graph, you know. Gray graph.
Oh.
Yeah, appearing there.
Oh, okay.
Now we get our Cisco WebEx meeting screen from you. You're probably sharing the, you know, same screen, this WebEx screen.
You know what? Let me just go on saying, and I could probably share
please,
this with you.
Please, yeah? Go ahead. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So as I was saying, that it's an age of digital dawn. There are around 450 million internet subscribers, and most of them are below the age of 25. With around out of the 8 people who access internet, 7 of them are accessing this through mobile phones. Similarly, millennials and the generations after prefer to get their news primarily from their phones, which is a great chance to create a digital media brand and properties that involve them in a more now, this is, again, from an India Spend point of view, in a virtuous cycle of democracy. So digital media in the 21st century will fuel development of new citizens and refashion the way we see our democracy. I think like a very good example here could be a lot of protests that we saw in the months of December, January. In fact, we even had a database running at that point of time, which was called the Protest Monitor, which were where we were tracking these protests, and most of these protests were people were engaged into this through the use of social media. Then another very important thing why you see so many new media outlets mushrooming out is also the low cost of the entry, low cost of investment that goes towards creating digital platforms. They are minimal, but they are very intelligently invested. Like I can, again, if you look at India spend, when we started off, I think our major, other than salaries, the other biggest chunk was just our website, which was pretty much the only thing that we used. Afterwards, whatever graphs and this that you see now are basically those that have been used from, you know, we started with the free versions, then we went on to the paid versions of those particular programs. And another very important thing, it's also a sad part, is that a lot of talented editors and middle-rung journalists are also who find themselves out of a job from legacy media houses where they used to work, are now moving towards digital media brands. So, for example, our former editor, Samar Halankar, was the editor of Hindustan Times. We had, we also have Faye D'Souza working for us. We see Barkha Dutt starting her own thing. So, you know, it has also provided kind of a window of opportunity for these good or these journalists to kind of put their point of view forward in a much more, you know, less controlled way. And now mobile phones are, as I said earlier, that seven out of the eight people who access internet in our country access it through mobile phones. And you see smartphones have risen from 2 million to almost 300 million. And again, this is an older figure, 2017 figure. Internet traffic again has grown. And just yesterday, I was talking to someone from Maharashtra police who also told us that even the amount of time today, we are spending a much larger amount of time on internet, whereas we spent, say, around 2 to 3 hours. Today, we are spending around more than 6 to 8 hours in the last 3 months alone. So seeing this, there is, you know, now that in the times of COVID also, you can see why there is a need for a niche media. If you even today go and check any other legacy media and what the kind of issues and things that are being talked about and what are the real issues on ground, there's a huge gap and divide. Like just yesterday, you know, rather than talking about, there were a lot of tweets yesterday about how nobody is talking about the Amphan cyclone. But there was an actual TV, there was a TV debate that was going on about how ASI had found Ram Mandir remains and, you know, that sort of stuff. So that kind of tells you the gap that that is to be filled. And I think new media kind of, you know, are actually able to fill this gap. Because in legacy media, you can see owners are cutting already weak coverage. Staff are focusing on too many things. Most of the things are news of the day or sensationalism. There is a lack of perspective, context, or in-depth coverage which is missing. Like, you know, just in the last 3 months, around 2,000 journalists have lost their jobs. And owners have again slashed their budgets as well. So, you can see them as the push and pull factors towards why new media or niche journalism is coming up. One important issue why we do this is also that urgent need to focus attention on a range of vital but undercovered issues. Like, for example, health, there's environment, jobs, education, poverty, agriculture, and science. These are some of the often neglected areas. In fact, if you see India spend, we cover only five main areas, which is health, education, climate change, gender, and governance. That's it. So we do not even go beyond these because there's so much to report in these areas. So again, this is another factor that I have observed through my career here at India Spend, is that, you know, social media can no longer be ignored. If you're a niche journalist organization, you have to make a social media presence felt. So for example, you know, how many India Spend alone has around 50,000 followers on Twitter. And similarly for Fact Checker, there's a whole different number there. So we primarily have made our presence felt on the new media today. So a little bit about India Spend. We launched in 2011, and in 2012 we launched this website called Fact Checker. It's basically 2014 is when we launched Fact Checker, which kind of was an proper website which checks facts in, say, Prime Minister's speech, the speeches given by ministers or even MPs and MLAs elsewhere. So these are people who have to be held accountable for what they say in public spaces. So Fact Checker was specifically designed for this particular purpose. Then moving forward, we have had different fellowships. Recently closed fellowship was a fellowship on mental health that we had. We have also had a land rights fellowship. Other than that, because of the continuing coverage, we have received quite a few awards. You know, there we have received the fellowship for, we have received the Reach Lily MDR award for TV stories. There is, we have both won the American and the European Cancer Award for reporting on our series on cancer. It's a very interesting series that I would definitely like to talk about later. Finally, I myself, beginning of this year, won the award for best for three for all my three stories around road accidents. So, to bring into context what we do, or you know, some numbers are. So far, we have produced somewhere to towards the upward end of 3,500, more than 3,500 stories, we have had around 20 editors, reporters, data influencers. We have we also conduct trainings for journalists, journalists and civil society organizations. We have trained around 400 plus journalists and civil society members. These trainings basically are of two kinds. We try, one is on fact checking. How do you fact check news? How do you fact check people? Second part is looking at the second part is also talking, making journalists, especially mid-career journalists, more familiar with data. And how do you use data or incorporate data intelligently in your stories? So these are some of the trainings that we do. Our major stakeholders that we consider in India Spend are our policymakers, media influencers, you know, civil society organization, and also the youth and data enthusiasts, which kind of really power the things that we do. There have been a lot of people who have engaged with India Spend to create some fantastic data pieces. Now, to what is our focus? Our focus is to research. We not only bring, there are some things that we do is, there's a lot of research that comes out, you know, a research that is conducted by civil society organizations, laboratories, academic institutions. But what generally happens is a lot of this research gets stuck in those particular silos. It doesn't break out of that. So that is one role that we do particularly, which is to kind of put together these data, you know, read these papers ourselves, read them completely, always. And read these papers and kind of put them in a much more understandable language. Similarly, what we also do is using our social media presence today, we kind of not only spread our stories through the social media, through Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, and so on, but we also kind of syndicate a lot of our content. So earlier I'd spoken about legacy media having this niche. So actually we have found like a lot of mainstream media outlets picking up articles or data stories that we do. So we have NDTV, Business Standard, Hindustan Times. These stories have been syndicated and go that way as well. We have also another thing we believe in, that if data does not exist for a particular issue, we always strive to actually get that data, you know, to kind of fill that gap. So for this, I would like to bring here, I would like to talk about our cancer series. And the reason for this is that we wanted to do a story about cancer, which wasn't talking about, you know, the cure for cancer or some of the regular topics. We wanted to talk about people who were outside Tata Memorial Hospitals, people who were living on the streets. They were patients who were coming there with families and living there. We wanted to do a story about that, but we found out that there was no data per se around it. So what we ended up doing is myself, my colleague Swagata, and my one of our interns actually managed to put together a questionnaire, which we then vetted from two data enthusiasts, you know, who data enthusiasts who used to work who work with JPAL, to vet out the whole questionnaire, and they also helped us in tabulating the data properly. And we got together, we got a very good sizable, like we spoke to around 50 or 60 people to kind of gather data on that. And we actually ended up finding out what is the actual impact, the monetary impact that is felt by a family who is dealing with cancer. So it's not just the medicines or treatment, it's also the amount of days of work lost, not just for the patient, but for the people who sit with the who are outside with the patients, you know, families, or where do they stay, what do they eat every day. It was a very rich data set, and hence it was a very rich story to come out of it. It's a three-part series. I would definitely urge all of you who are interested in doing data journalism to look at that. It's a very good example for that. So as I said, we always are trying to fulfill gaps in data, be it through doing our own surveys or looking out for research papers. And sometimes we even just collaborate with a lot of our partners. We have collaborated with the World Bank, with Harvard University, with other journalist niche journalist organizations like Khabar Leharia, Video Volunteers, multilateral foundations like the Gates Foundation, Population Fund of India. These guys also help. What happens is when you have these many people coming in and weighing in on your stories, you have a much more 360 degree view of a particular story, and not just you know, a cut paste copy of, oh, data goes up, data goes down. That's not your story. The story is, why is it doing that? And our field of interest, as I mentioned earlier, are health sanitation and nutrition, education, climate change, agriculture, and gender. And how do we do it? These are few of the sheets that I can give you. One, the oldest one, is to be informed. Read, 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 and read some more. Know your technology. Learn to shoot, edit, connect, multitask. You know, in today's world, you can no longer be a journalist who can just sit and write good articles. It's about the ability to make a good podcast, or to even shoot something, to take your own pictures, or to take your own videos, you know. And another thing is walk the street, explore more, talk to people, and travel. Now, whatever stories that you see today are stories as a result of us talking not just to the experts, but also trying to bring out stories and case studies. It's very important to have case studies, you know, because often many a times when you write data, a lot of it looks, you know, very dead, mundane. It doesn't, but instead, if you have a case study, you can kind of embellish on the data, you know, you can kind of show a good this. So I'll show you some of the examples in our COVID coverage. Now, another one is learn to work cooperatively. So this is very important, as I mentioned above, that we have had a lot of cooperation, collaborations and partnerships. There are a lot of collaborations within India Spend. We work with each other. One of my recent stories, I worked with my new colleague, Anu Bhuyan. We worked together to figure out how much what was the amount of money that has come into PM CARES Fund. If she decided to do this by herself, this would have taken her 10 days and she would have definitely missed out on this story. But instead, it was me and her sitting and going through again and again and putting together that piece, which is now kind of almost gone viral today. So working collaboratively really helps. Also, collaboration shouldn't just be within the organization, they should be without as well. You should be collaborating with academic institutions, you should be collaborating with other media houses, you should be collaborating with data enthusiasts. Whenever anybody writes to India Spend, we don't clearly say yes or no to them, because we always think that there is something that some person can always contribute to us. And last is stay connected. If you come to India Spend, you'll see most of us have our Twitter, WhatsApp, and something or the other actually open. So it's very different from an academic point of view, where we are told to switch off our phones and, you know, just pay attention. But actually, to kind of figure out what is actually happening, it's very important to stay connected. Now, why do we do all of this? One important reason is that a lot of debate that goes on in India today, even in policy sections, a lot of it is not backed by solid data, which is a problem. Because a lot of this, you'll be amazed to know that beyond 2003, there are no proper records of, you know, how many people received midday meals or PMGSYs or anything. So, you know, it's actually quite shocking to know that this is not very, it's almost not even been 20 years since we are seeing all this data come out. Transparency obviously leads to better accountability. We also believe that better data-backed arguments also help spark civic engagement. And we have seen this happen at India Spend, where we have reported on our stories on, say, droughts in Andhra, where the governments have reached out to us, asked us about particular set of people, who did we speak to, who are these people, and so on. So definitely that is something, one of the reasons why we also do that, the on-ground impact. Another reason is to sharing best practices and learning. So at India Spend, you will see that all our stories are not exactly everything is bleak and, you know, you're going to die tomorrow. There's a lot more to it. You know, we also want to bring out examples where things are working, because they need to be communicated effectively, because those models can be emulated. And there's a lot of work that is happening around, which is good work, and that needs to be told. And finally, apply storytelling to data and facts in order to provide citizens, bureaucracy, judiciary, and government an in-depth perspective on socio-economic issues. So, as I said, this is the reason we do it, so that we can back people up with good data and in-depth perspective, so that people can understand a particular crisis, not just in one particular way, but in overall in trying to provide a 360 degree angle. So this was my small chat about what we do at India Spend. If you want, I could start my COVID coverage stories and then come back, or if there are questions right now also people can ask.
No, I think you first please present your COVID coverage at India Spend.
Okay.
Then probably towards the end of the talk we can ask you questions and all.
Okay. I am, can you guys at least see the tabs open or something? The India Spend website.
No, it's just a graph kind
no?
of a, no.
I
think you need to share. You first go to the browser and then share.
Yeah.
You go to the browser and share.
Okay.
Share that one.
Share content.
Yes. Now we can see your browser.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Is it shareable now?
Yes. We get it.
Okay. Great.
Yes. So, yes. Now we can.
All right. So this is something that we have been slaving over ever since the COVID crisis began. This is the coronavirus monitor that India Spend has been doing for So this is what we have put together. It's a tracker that looks at active cases, total cases, discharge and death. We also have something called a map on testing centers across the country. We keep populating this as and when. If you click on every this, you can see where it is in your area. There is also statewide trends that we do. Oh yeah, so this is a very cool graph that we have done. So as the days go forward, you can see which states started taking over the others. This is all thanks to our wonderful team at the data team at India Spend that have been doing this for us. This back-breaking work. So yeah. And check it later. Just some of these, and then district wise coverage, which are the coverage. And finally, you can click on any one of them. It gives you confirmed cases and which place is this. And finally, the hotspots, which are the orange and the red spots in India. Now, again, see, one thing I would definitely like to point out here is this, that a lot of this is based on the data that is available to us. We see, so as you can see over here, we have data only for Mumbai, Delhi, where we are receiving some sort of a regular coverage on this. But otherwise, many other cities are, it's not possible. So we are trying to create something, but so far we are facing a lot of issues around that. And here is the COVID related cases in Mumbai and Delhi, and then doubling days and so on. So this is the data part of things. Then there are stories that we are also doing otherwise. So one of the stories that has been published is today's story on migrant crisis, what is happening there. But we are also doing interviews and so on. And there is one particular story that I would like to just bring out. these are very two examples that I will be using. So for example, as I was saying that, you know, a good story should not just have data in it, but should also have a human face to the whole thing. So if you read the story here, it begins with a story of a friend of a friend who suffers from leukemia, sorry, who suffers from thalassemia, not leukemia. What they have actually, what I actually did is, so we have a lot, she's saying and telling me the story begins that way, where we are discussing how it is that what she does in order to get blood, blood donations, because she needs a transfusion every 15 days. And then we actually move forward and go into talk to, we also spoke to somebody from KEM. We also spoke to the Federation of Blood Banks in Mumbai. And then we also, to actually find out that the shortage of blood is not a big, new issue. It's not just something COVID related. It's actually something that's been happening for quite some time. And one of the reasons for that is that there are too many blood banks in India with not enough storage facilities. And that is what is causing the problem. So, so you know what, we have actually then gone ahead and spoken spoken to people who have policy makers and others who are kind of explaining what is it that, you know, you that needs to be done. So we learned of this idea that has been going around quite a lot, that is called the e-Raktakosh, which is basically kind of creating a hub and spoke model for blood donations and blood delivery. So technically it means a major, big blood bank being at one point, and it's and others will be just storage centers. So in case if somebody needs blood, they can, this particular hub can provide information where is their closest blood bank and not actually blood donation center. So there, this kind of tells you about a 360 degree view. You know, you go in looking at a story saying that, oh, you know, we are, there is a shortage of blood because there's COVID happening or because there's a lockdown in place. But then you kind of realize that this is not the case. There is, this has been happening for quite some time now. And it's just, in fact, I also learned that these months from Jan to, actually from, sorry, from April to June are actually months where people who suffer from thalassemia or blood banks actually go ahead to run dry, because students who are apparently the biggest blood donors in the country go back home. So, you know, a lot of cities like Delhi, Mumbai, Lucknow actually face a lot of problem and shortage. The shortage is the least during November, December, because, you know, people are more in that giving mood and kind of there are a lot more donations happening. So, yeah, you come to know things. And this is the story that I was telling you about, which is about the PM CARES Fund and how, as I said, now this is a classic example. We did not have data on this. We did not have any official data telling us how much money is there. So we at India Spend decided that let's go and find out more about this, or how do we do this. So this is what we decided. We went through PIB, the Public Information Bureau, and we looked at business newspapers to figure out private and public donations to the PM CARES Fund. And again, there are two different distinctions that we made. One is the amount that has actually been donated, and the second is the amount that is being pledged. Hence, the number that you see, 1.27 billion, is that. And finally, context is very important for any story. So, you know, if I tell you, oh, it's rupees 9,000 crore, you will say, yeah, it's a big amount. But if you put it in context, like, you know, for example, the entire amount can purchase 145 million PPE for staff, or it can provide 138 million tickets at a price of 700 from Vadodara to Lucknow. So, you know, when these numbers come to you, you're like, oh, okay. Or for example, you know, you could do around 21.5 million tests, 21.5 million tests for the RT-PCR test. So these are some of the stories that we have done so far at India Spend. And yeah, if you have questions, I'm always eager.
Okay, do we have any questions from participants, any observations or any additions to be made? You know, you can just, you know, put in your points.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, please.
So can you enable the chat option where I can type the question if, you know, if there is a network glitch, my question cannot get across?
It's already enabled. You can also speak. Speak, we are able to listen to you.
Okay, ma'am. Hello, ma'am. It was a really informative session. And I was paying quite an attention to how you were, you know, pointing out how important digital media will be after the crisis or within as we are, you know, surfing through the crisis. And there is one thing called the digital media ethics. And we have read how it is spread horizontally and virtually and how it functions in both. So how do you think this crisis will help in evolving these digital media ethics, which were already in a huge pool of question marks?
Okay. Can I answer one by one or this?
Yes, ma'am, you can go one by one. That's fine.
Oh, okay. Okay. So in terms of digital media ethics, now this is a very loaded question. But also something you may have seen along with the fact that there are opportunities, but then there are opportunities for all kinds of players. So for example, I'm currently working on a story on frauds or fake news, you know, and in fact, one story we have done is on fake news, that during COVID, the spread of fake news has actually gone up. And gone up four times than what it was in January. So you can imagine that the number of fake news is going up. And also there's this whole thing that digital media ethics, although they exist, but not a lot of organizations are actually following it. So there is, because you might see that legally we are not under any control as such. And then there is a lot of debate going on about who's not fake news media and who's fake news media. Like, for example, we are signatories to something called the IFCN, the International Fact Checking Organization Network. These guys provide you how to do fact checks or what are considered as fact checks. That where are your sources from? Have you spoken to people others? And also another thing. But now when we are doing it, we are following all of these guidelines. When we put out our fact checks, they have to go through those particular set of criteria to be followed. But then there are other websites that do fact checks on the fact checks that we are doing and expect to be a part of IFCN. Now it is up to IFCN to figure out, but then you can see what a dodgy ground that is, that, you know, is that even a fact check or is it not a fact check? That's a whole different thing. And as I said, digital media ethics remain a large part of it in theory. Very few organizations are actually following those.
Okay, ma'am, there's one more question. As you've already, shown us some examples of how India Spends goes about the data collected, or how it goes about, processing data into its story. So this activity must require some sort of skill that deals with how you package the data into the stories. How do you think people like us who have, for example, I'm just graduating and I don't have the know-how to package the data or even to dissect it for my comprehension. How do you think people like us can approach this particular sort of profession which requires data dissecting?
Well, it's a very good question because to begin with, I am not a journalist by training. I am a researcher who's moved in here. But also, I have found we also have something called the India Spend Internship Program, where which has been going on for the last 8, 9 years now. So what we basically I have found is that young people who are just out of college are actually much more capable of adapting themselves to this new media and to the kind of ideas we demand from people. We demand from journalists. Seasoned journalists actually find it more difficult to kind of move into me. Like my most favorite example to give is when I started working. Health today is one of my mainstays. But when I started off, I was pretty much just reporting on, something like the infant mortality rate, which is death, children born, dead children born per 1,000 live births. So basically, that's what I started with, So the beginning I started was just reporting, oh, this number is going high. But as I said, that is not the story. The story is why is it going high? So I would suggest approach it more as a question to approach it more as a research question than actually like a media story. So think of it like this: when we start, like when I started working, the reason why the infant or more children are dying becomes you then start investigating why is that happening. So then you come to know it's malnutrition, it is sanitation, it is not vaccination. All of these reasons then become stories in themselves. So what approach it in terms of what you would approach a research question and not an article. But the only thing which is different at India Spend is the only thing that will that you can do actually is this one thing. Only thing different than what it is in terms of a regular research paper is in research papers, our findings are all the way below. Our main findings, our observations are all the way below. You just have to put them on top, and then the rest of the paper remains the same. It takes, but this is a simple formula, simple way of doing it. But as I said, and I personally have found that students are more easily able to adapt to this than seasoned journalists because they have a particular way of approaching things. Students actually have a much more open mind to these issues. So I see no issues of, you not being able to do stories like this. As I said, approach it more as a research question and not as a set agenda that you're going to prove something.
Great, great, great. Ma'am, Savita Agarwal has a question. Ma'am, would you like to ask it through audio or shall I translate your
She, a ma'am, is unable to unmute.
Okay.
So, Imran, you can go ahead and ask.
Okay.
Okay.
So, ma'am, Savita Agarwal is asking. Okay, I'm on. Let me just unmute her. Okay. She's asking, is there a fine line dividing mainstream media from alternate media? Is there a fine line dividing mainstream media from alternative media? So
I would say
more academic question.
I would say there's a Grand Canyon that is dividing mainstream media at alternative media.
Wow.
And mainly because it's not just because of the way the stories or the focus of our stories that we do and what others do, but what mainstream media does, but also the way we approach it. And it's not just India's, I'm talking from an India spend point of view, I'm talking from a wire point of view or from a print point of view. We tend to go in depth and into issues which usually people would not be looking at. So it's that. And also, as I said, that a lot of what we do today are, as I said, there's a not a lot of investment that goes in. We are, if you come to the India Spend office and look at the work that we do, you'll be amazed. It's a, overall, it's a 17-person team, which is running 3 websites and a video channel. So that should tell you the amount of work that we do along with this. And for example, even our journalists today, they are more multi-talented, you know, they are multitasking at a given point of time. We are not just, when we go to the field, we are not just thinking of the story on how it will appear in a written website, but also how does it look at, sometimes even sound bites and so on. So that if you see some stories, like the really long investigations that we have done, they are also looking at pictures, they have videos, they have sound bites. We even do podcasts about these things. So a lot of it is like, you know, so it's out of that one story, you can pull out at least 3 mediums that can talk, that can convey the message of that story to you. So that is another thing. So it's the total amount of investment required is not as high. The amount of issues that we cover are very different than what mainstream media covers. And lastly, the distribution levels, you know, for niche media or alternative media are much far widespread than actually mainstream. Mainstream, if you see mainstream, Economic Times or Times of India, that is on that is online or that's on Twitter right now, or that's on Facebook right now. The numbers might say for example, India Spend, all the numbers that you see there are organic followers. None of them are paid followers. That's the case with other alternative media as well. That a lot of them actually think that we, whatever we have been able to create, the influence or the sphere of our influence, it's all organic. That might not be the case with mainstream media.
Prachi, we have a question from Subhashini. She's a student, second-year student. She's writing,
okay.
Hello, ma'am. Subhashini this side. A practical and simple question. We have been hearing that jobs are going away. So will journalism survive in the context of COVID-19 and coming years? Is it not dangerous to report in the times of pandemic as corona is here to stay for some more time?
Okay, we have been reporting. As I said, things will get difficult before they get better, for sure. We are going, and I think journalism is one sort of a profession that you get in because you are interested. You don't come in here for the money. Very few journalists actually come in, they come here out of passion. And I personally think that even though, yes, we are seeing big level job cuts in mainstream media, even alternative media is suffering. I'm not going to lie about that. But the thing is that because I think that even if, I won't say mainstream media would completely go away, it will stay, but it will also be a place where only few channels or few media outlets will survive, you know, which kind of put in only the 2 left or right ideologies. Only those few of them will remain, others may not. because it's a very competitive market. And yes, it is dangerous. There are reporters who are testing positive for me for this, but it's also, remember that it's an essential service. At the end of the day, you need to know whether it's safe to go outside or not. So it was a very welcome move by the Prime Minister to consider us essential services. But as I said, will journalism survive? Yes, definitely. As long as there are good journalists, journalism will survive.
Excellent. So, Prachi, we have a question from Professor Parveen Pannu, ma'am. Ma'am, if you are able to speak, could you please put up your question?
Yes, thank you, Imran. I would like to ask the question from Prachi, and that is, how do you deal with a concept of agenda setting, which is all around us all the time, and the whole media, whether it is digital or, you know, mainstream, there's a lot of agenda setting going on. So every story gets impacted with it. Please elaborate, shed light on your experiences on that. Thank you.
Well, I would like to tell you that after working for so long and also being a student of economics, I am of the firm belief that agenda setting happens everywhere. But how much of hard logic are you going to put behind your particular debate that you're making is very important. And in terms of, for example, India Spend tries to be as neutral as possible for something like, we in our style sheet, there's a clear cut guideline that says we will not be using adjectives at all. So if you have to prove something, you have to be ready with your numbers, you have to be ready with your expert comments, you have to be ready to show that whatever you're saying actually has logic behind it. So for example, the PM CARES Fund. Now, the idea of the article isn't to incite people or anything. The idea is to put the information out there that now, since nobody is telling us in the government that what is the amount of money that is available, this is something we are doing together. You know, this is what we found out from different press releases and so on. If we are wrong, we would like the government to come out and tell us that, no, this is a wrong figure. This is the idea is, the speaking truth to the power, to power, right? Just trying, the idea is to bring out with data journalism, I personally find that it is going to get a little more difficult because we see that the government, every new government doesn't want to put out as much data as the previous government was putting out. So, you have to figure out new ways, you have to find out new collaborations and so on, which can actually where you can bring in as many perspectives as possible.
Okay, thank you. Yuki ma'am, you have a question. Could you please relay the question?
Hi Prachi, it was very interesting presentation, first of all. And now I want to also understand that nowadays you mentioned about fake news and the fake news is rising during COVID-19 days. Also, most of us have started relying on the data on different websites. Yeah. So dealing with fake news and relying too much on government data, how are you dealing with it, and how we as a audience, as a receiver of information, should strike a balance between the both, and how we can identify which news is correct and which is organic, which is paid? You know what is organic and paid. How as an audience we get to know that?
Okay, what we are doing, it's a two-pronged answer. First part is, yes, fake news are growing up. In fact, the more we stay at home, the more we rely on online sources to provide us information, and we don't know which of that information is correct or not correct. The way we deal with it is by making sure that the information is vetted through different sources, you know, or contextualizing it. You know, for example, when we say that, oh, India is dealing with COVID so much better, but we have always maintained that India's spread. If you look any of our stories that go on particularly about COVID, this is also about the number of COVID tests. And yes, in India, the numbers are not good, or per capita testing is what we always call it. If you government is putting out those numbers, but then you can always contrast it with numbers from, say, UK or Italy and so on. So it's not, and also the number of tests that those guys are doing compared to the tests that we are doing. So it's always, it kind of provides you a better point of view to kind of question that data. So whenever government puts out a data, we don't take it as is. You have to question the data. You have to use different sources. Like, we use multilateral sources, like, you know, go and see what World Bank says. So, you know, if India, one very good example that we had done was a fact check that we had done on the UPA government's claim, saying that they had added almost 3 years to a person's life, to an average Indian's life. So, second is very important is what we also second is, as I said in one of my tips, is read and read some more. Because if you read, if you start reading more from different news outlets, you will kind of understand the agenda behind it, what one news is saying. If it's not similar, then you can definitely try and pick those things out. And thirdly, what we also do as India Spend, we also provide training to something called fake news training. So we are doing some of these with children in 10th and 11th standard, and even in colleges, where we are trying doing these training workshops where we teach people them about fake news. How do you identify fake news? What do you do? How do you approach someone with fake news? And I see a lot of this will, we see a lot of students kind of coming forward and asking us questions. There are some tools that we use. It's something called reverse Google image search. If you think that some image is not right, you can run a Google image search in that and kind of see where that image was earlier published. So there are little tricks, and these are the tricks that we do share in this. In fact, tomorrow we are going to be speaking to one such IAS officer who, with the help of India Spend and Fact Checker and Boom News, did these district-wise training workshops and so on, identifying fake news. So we there is a chat with him tomorrow. So you know there are ways coming out as well. Like I won't say everything is bleak. People are waking up to the fact that maybe everything we should be taking everything with a pinch of salt.
Excellent. Preek, you have a question, please ask.
Hi, Prachi ma'am, this is Preksha. I'm a final year student at IHE. I wanted to ask you what is the level of data proficiency as a development, as a data journalist that you need to have? Like, as you mentioned, that you yourself did not handle the graphs and stats for the many stories out there. But at the same time, you need to be aware of how does the data work. What is the level of data proficiency as a data journalist you think a journalist must possess?
Well, I would suggest it, first and foremost, you should be comfortable with Excel. And second is ability to look at unending lines of data for a really long time, because that is sometimes literally what we do. And and it's very important to be able to. And I don't think there are any specific set of skills that we need. You just need to be comfortable with numbers, you know. Many a times, you know, if you're not able to, you know, like as I said, we basically work with an Excel sheet. We don't apply any hype undo things as well. We also, another thing is we also stay away from correlation and causation or regression analysis, because imagine writing that for a layperson. So we kind of don't go there, but if there are specific writers who can actually do it, they're always welcome. But coming back, what kind of this that we need is not much. You should be comfortable with numbers. That's very important. And secondly, you should be able to use a Excel sheet at least, because that can be a stepping stone from which we can build up from. And secondly, when it comes to all these fancy, you know, visualization tools that are available, they are very easy to use, but they are one of those things that you actually have to spend a little time on. And I'm sure that shouldn't be an issue. If you have extra skills of scraping and so on, always welcome. But to start off, I think it should be comfortability with numbers and ability to use Excel sheets. Those are your two basic things that we need, so that you can always build up on that. Like for something, even for data visualization, a Tableau or something, also in the end of the day uses an Excel sheet. So if you feed your Excel sheet data into Tableau, you'll get all the visualizations that you see. So that's why you need to be comfortable with these two things.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. I just wanted to quickly congratulate you on the PM Care story as well. I mean, there was a dearth of data on that bad. And I went through the story, and the way you made sense of the data, that how we could, you know, buy these many commodities using the PM Care's fund, that was brilliant. So I just wanted to congratulate you on that. And thank you for the answer. Thank you.
Okay, great. Prapti Bhatia, third year student, is asking, ma'am, does your organization consider using data for which you cannot name the source? For example, data coming from inside a source in a government office. From anonymous sources.
Anonymous sources. Usually, see, as long as there is a PDF for it, we tend to, see, the thing with India Spend is that we have this habit of, and within our style sheet also, it's mentioned that you have to hyperlink all the sources that are there. So even if you see any of the stories that I've shown you today, you hover over the hyperlinks, you will know exactly where we got it from. In case of, anonymous sources and so on, if your source is comfortable that we put that information on a hard drive and put it there, on the Google hard drive and hyperlink it to our stories, I think that's completely fine. Because many a times we have had this in the past where some stories that we have done, a lot of village panchayat data is not available. Like, it is available, but you have to be really pally with the tehsildar, someone in the tehsildar office. And some of our journalists have actually gone ahead, got that data, and then put it all on a hard drive, which we have then linked to the source, which we have then hyperlinked. So technically, it is all there. But as I said, sources, and again, you have to be very careful as to, you know, what is your data saying, whether it's authentic data or not. And because you work with data, you will know whether or not is it at least close to what your idea is. Because that's very important. You know, if somebody tomorrow comes and tells me ki, oh, you know, only 10% of toilets have been built under Swachh Bharat, I will be very skeptical of that data, because you know, I would need more proof than just a piece of paper saying that. I might need like the MIS numbers or something, because that won't be correct. I know toilets have been built, but not, I know they are less, but not that less.
Prachi, we have one more question from Akansha. She is asking, as we have observed that during Corona apocalypse, the integrated media houses have cut down the number of pages and stories in the print version because of the lack of revenues, and rather are publishing more stories on their digital platforms. In fact, it's thereby changing the consumer behavior. People are shifting towards digital media. What will be the fate of print media in metropolitan cities as well as in the context with regional media?
Well, a good question. What I would like to say is, yes, there is a shift towards the digital. There is a loss of ad revenues that is happening. But on the other hand, I don't think print would be completely dead, because I think print media even today offers a kind of analysis and in-depth, you know, think pieces as well, which is very important to kind of influence, if not all of us, but at least a certain section of the society. So, but on the other hand, they could always move all of this towards towards digital. But then some of the news media organizations have actually started putting a paid sort of this, like, you know, Hindu is asking for donations to support good journalism. Similarly, Business Standard puts out, actually has a paywall for all their think pieces. So then I think I see that mainstream media might actually, and I don't know how many takers there will be for actually paid this. But if we go by the international example of Wall Street Journal and FT, they actually ended up successfully monetizing them. And I see financial newspapers actually being able to do that. But I'm not sure about general newspapers.
Excellent. Natasha Rohan is asking, I wanted to ask, as a data journalist, how do you balance the need to go in depth or investigate thoroughly a piece of information and the need to get it published while it's still in news, you know, evolving news, Joe, developing news?
Right. Well, see, what we also, there's always temptation to go deeper. As somebody who comes from a research background, there are times where I want to investigate even further. But then you also have to keep in mind that, you know, no matter how So what at India Spend we actually end up doing is breaking up stories by parts, you know. So for example, if we are we did an investigation on Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. So our initial first piece that was out was on the fact that with so many toilets being built, what is going to happen to the sewer system in the country? And that was you know, a low hanging fruit. A lot of people would be reaching out for that. So we actually expedited that story. But during that, we also came to know that on-ground reality is very different. In, say, a state like Gujarat or a state like Uttar Pradesh, things are very different. And there, we found a lot of differences. So what we actually did was we first pushed out this piece, and then we had two subsequent pieces, one looking at Gujarat and one looking at Uttar Pradesh, kind of bringing out pictures from those areas as well. So there is a lot of this. And secondly, I think it also doesn't mean that you do a half-ass work and send your piece out there. You know, like, for example, with PM Cares, there was a story just the night before this piece got published, piece by Times of India was also there. Which said that this number was far higher for them. It was like 1.49 billion. But we actually then went back to our data, looked at our data, figured out why the difference is coming through. And then we made that particular this differentiation between donation and pledge. But then, you know, so we took our time because we knew we had something more than what the Times of India piece did not have. So it's always it's always good to put out a piece which you are sure of, rather than getting caught up in the rat race. Because what happens is many a times when you push out a piece quickly, you might end up sending wrong information out there, which you don't want, because that totally hurts your credibility more than anything.
Brilliant, Prachi. We have one, I think, the last question from Dr. Jagriti Kher. She's a faculty member at our department. So she's asking, does India spend publish its own reports or papers on different issues on primary data collected, apart from the secondary data collected? As I have seen some secondary data on your platform, but not able to find any primary research. So,
As I said, the data collection or anything that we do right now at India Spend is, our role, we know very much, is more that of a communicator than actually of some body of research that is producing original pieces. What we basically want to do when, for example, the cancer piece that I told you about, that I spoke about, that piece was more in tandem to, we did that to put a light on that particular topic, to shed a light on that topic that, hey, there are these people who are living outside Tata Memorial Hospital, and they have problems which are not just that we have cancer, but cancer is impacting their life in a very different way. So that's why, one of the reasons why we actually won an award from both the European and the American Cancer Research Agency is because nobody had thought about it. The social cost of cancer is what we termed that research. Our aim of doing that was not to kind of put out a new paper out there or something, or put out a peer-reviewed paper. Our idea was to shine the light on that issue so that tomorrow other researchers and so on can come there, or the best example is JPAL or any other university, because we had two people from JPAL who helped us with the questionnaire and the data tabulation. They put a that the idea is to shine a light. It is not to become another organization that puts out papers or something. We are very firm in our role as a communicator.
Excellent. I don't see there are any more questions as comprehensive as the talk could be. Your responses to questions were as brilliant as they could ever be. So, but connecting with...
Can I ask one question?
Prabhjot Kaur, could you... Yeah. She is the faculty member at DCEJ. Prabhjot, please ask. Please go ahead.
First of all, I would like to really congratulate you. And seriously, it was an amazing session and very in-depth information we have got and a lot of data we had talked about. I would like to ask you a comprehending question, that which is that what would be the new normal for all the young journalists? So now, you know, we all are on digital platforms. So just, you know, as your experience, a second, you know, addition to my question that, you know, I want to ask you personally that how do you think and this pandemic or is going to last and in India, what according to you would be the timeline and for all the journalists to really grow in the digital media and also maybe, you know, work in the field because it is an essential service as per the government, Indian government.
Well, to answer your first as a journalist, I think the role of a journalist is going to change quite a bit. You are no longer just a print journalist, or you're not just a video journalist. You are everything rolled into one. You are even the radio show host for your this as well. So because the thing is, it's how media is, you know, like for us at India Spend, there are some very, very fantastic, we are a part of something called the Global Investigative Journalism Network, GIJN. And we have seen some amazing work that is happening abroad, be it like, you know, Turkey, Pakistan, Bangladesh, some amazing work. Like one story I'll tell you, it has still stayed with me and it's been like 5 years. This story was about a slum in Pakistan in Rawalpindi. So what this journalist had done, they had gotten the 360 degree camera and they had taken images from that particular slum and it was and created an interactive dashboard. You could click on a picture of a person and you could see that person's entire story just open up, you know, or you could pick and you know there were sound effects of what does a slum sounds like, you know, and then there were video clips of, you know, this person talking about this little cottage industry that was there. So it was a very, it was truly a 360 degree way of telling a story. Then there was something on that we saw from Turkey, which was basically this piece where they had collected data of all the murders or crimes against women, particularly murders that had happened in Turkey. And they had plotted it on the map and you could click on every one of them and it would open up into the story itself of that particular murder, how did it happen and everything. And there was a larger story about how women are dying because of domestic violence. So it was truly mind-blowing, you know. So, and again, a lot of different mediums were used to communicate that one message. But then it was so engaging that if you actually converted these pieces into one story, you would never have anyone reach the end of those stories. You know, because why are we? It's a interesting way of storytelling, and at the end of the day we are storytellers with a little more responsibility, but at the end of the day we are storytellers and it has to be an engaging way to tell a story. And as far as the pandemic is concerned, from all our chats with different experts and epidemiologists and so on, one very important lesson we have learned is like right now a pandemic is going on, right? But if you see all the experts or so-called experts that are being called to mainstream media houses or so on, are anyone but an epidemiologist, which is really sad because epidemiologists are the ones who will tell you, looking at the data, that how long. So we actually didn't manage to speak to a couple of them, and most of them have actually pointed out to the fact that July seems to be the time where they see this ending or at least coming down. And as far as living with COVID is now pretty much a reality, because any vaccine which will come through will come in by next year. I think journalists are the most set of people who are most likely to do that, because we don't sit in our offices, we are always outside. Now the only thing we'll have to do is maintain social distancing while interviewing our subject, because that is one thing where I see a change is happening, you know, where you're, you can't just walk with your subject anymore, or you can't just, you know, be friendly with them as you otherwise would have been. But then I can still see some journalists doing some fantastic work, you know, when it comes to covering the migrant crisis, or even yesterday there was a very good report by Faye D'Souza on the insides of the insides of KEM hospital. It was amazing, that story, because it brought out what is actually happening there. Why is the Maharashtra government being so paranoid, you know, about creating more beds and so on? But so these stories are important because they give you a perspective and look at a disease which you earlier otherwise would not have. And in fact, I see journalists playing a much more vital role, because, you know, there is a debate on the left and there's a debate on the right. There's a debate on the right that let's open everything up, this is not a big deal, so on and so forth. And there's a debate on the left saying that, yeah, you don't care about workers anyways, you might as well send us to this. So at this point of time, it's very important work for a journalist to be able to show both sides and also try and be neutral to kind of show what is exactly happening on ground.
Brilliant. Prachi, I think your talk has been rather, like poetry, you know, something, you know. So we have got another response. Bableen Bakshi, our faculty member, is going to ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
Hi, Prachi. Yeah, hi. Imran is right. It is more of a stimulating talk that is, you know, instilling a lot of questions in our heads. So I want to ask you that you said telling a story through different medium, which is also nowadays called as transmedia storytelling, you know, especially when digital comes into picture, audience get an agency to react and respond through their comments. And do you think in journalism stories ever change, or does your organization, have you ever been told to take audience responses into consideration? And how do you see that, how do you see a story shifting or changing because of how people are responding? Are we yet there?
Well, not there yet, but I can definitely tell you this, that there are organizations in the US and so on that are that very actively keep track of Twitter trends and Google News trends and so on to kind of figure out what is going on people's mind, and then putting out exactly those stories. So there are actually organizations that are doing this. But on the other hand, I think we at IndiaSpend always, as I said, you know, we whenever we get a curious email or a response to the work that we do, we are always happy to take help from our readers, because some of them have, it's also what kind of reader is it, right? If it's like we have had responses from the government, or we have had responses from IAS officers, and we have had responses from nurses and ASHAs that work on ground saying that it was really nice to get that story out there. But, you know, there is this as well, you know, there is our side of the story as well, which you need to do. And I think if you as a journalist are truly curious about what about a story, you will go ahead and investigate even further, you know, something like, for example, I found this in many many news media outlets as well, you know, that a lot of the times only one particular side is covered, you know, like, oh, PHC mein kaam nahi ho raha hai because the ASHA and ANM is taking money. Okay, and that's where the story ends. I've seen stories ending at that, but that's not the full picture. The thing is, the ANM or the ASHA also has to run her own household. She also has to run the hospital, and she doesn't get a lot of money from the panchayat or the Ministry of Health, but she's expected to do not just give vaccinations to your baby, but also now with the new mental health policy, become your therapist also. So there are these demands, you know. So you have to either, I think, if like, and as I said, you know, we have had Asha's writing into us, who kind of put out those views as well, that, you know, this is not right. You need to see things from our perspective as well. And then I think it only enriches a story. So maybe I won't change the story that I have, but maybe I'll do another part of the story saying that, hey, this is there as well. And also, we do data stories. So to say that there are never mistakes in our data is not telling you guys the truth. There have been mistakes. And in fact, sometimes it's our readers who have pointed out those mistakes to us. And we always respond to them in the same way that we respond to all our readers, that thank you for pointing this out. And we really value the fact that you are actually reading our stories with that depth, that you are actually able to tell us that, hey, I think this number might be wrong. So, yeah.
Excellent.
Thank
Excellent.
You. Yeah, that answers my question. Thanks
Excellent
so much.
There. Are there any more questions? Because Prachi, we have got hold of, you know, very, it's like, so if anybody has any more questions, they could ask before we can sign off, because we have already. Okay. So Preeti Yadav is asking on our chat, ma'am, today our mainstream media is bifurcated between left and right ideologies. So it's right to leave it over to the wisdom of viewers to digest whatever being served or is, or if not, how should the third side of media to work, as partially lies at every side, even though media tries to work as neutral? If I can just paraphrase this question, yes. She's asking, like, you know, as we see, you know, prime time news and all. So, like, you know, our media being bifurcated into left and right ideologies per se. So she's asking for what could be the third kind of a, you know, space wherein we could, you know, practice journalism as a professional, you know, practice, wherein we could actually bring in much more rigor as media is supposed to bring in.
Well, so this comes more from a personal experience. I as a researcher as well, you know. So as a researcher also, I think when you're trying to do a paper or anything, you when you're trying to answer a research question, you are actually trying to incorporate all the different streams of thought in your literature review or wherever, where you're not just saying that, you know, there's this one school of thought which believes that private sector should be allowed into healthcare, and then there's another school of thought which believes no, public there should be only government hospitals. But as a researcher, you are supposed to find a way which works on both sides. It's not just supposed to be going with one and the other. I think in a different manner, even your journalists have to face the same thing. You know, there are different ideologies, there are different pulls, and this, that, and this. But as I said, one of the reasons why India Spend decided to go with data journalism is exactly this, that we believe that data cannot be partial to one side or impartial to another. Data is what it is, you know. No matter how good, say, suppose the state of Punjab is doing, or, you know, Captain Amrinder might be doing, but it also is a state that has some of the highest maternal mortality rates in the country, you know, among developed states. Similarly with UP, or even with Bihar, Nitish Kumar is seen as somebody who is, you know, the whole narrative is that he's somebody who actually does a lot of work and so on. But the data actually says that it's quite bad when it comes to maternal health or child health. Even in Kerala, for that matter, Kerala is seen as a very shining example of what healthcare can do. But data also shows that a lot of deliveries in Kerala today are happening in private sector and not public sector. So a lot of the good healthcare is being run by private sector and not public sector. So as I said, you know, so I think that's why incorporating data in stories is so important, because it kind of breaks down a lot of your own you know, your own biases into it. I found that myself, you know, coming from the state of Maharashtra, I had this whole idea that, oh, everything is fine, you know, you can get healthcare wherever you want. But when we see that the number of hospital beds in Maharashtra today is not enough, if you look at the national health profile, or the number of doctors is also not enough, that kind of breaks down your biases. You know, when you start looking at data, it breaks down your biases. You then have to, either you have to figure out a way around the whole thing, or you have to figure out a way to explain these things. And when you actually decide to explain that particular data or that particular anomaly, then you go even deeper. And that breaks down even further constructs that you have in your mind. So, you know, like the whole gender justice debate, it's always interesting to see, you know, how the best data set out there is, we say, oh, you know, women, urban area, women in urban areas are so much more empowered than women in rural areas, because, you know, they have education, they, you know, they drive cars and I don't know what else, but yeah. There are certain ideas and stereotypes, but what happens at that point of time is that you need to, but then you come to know that actually fewer women in India, in urban India, the employment rate for women in urban India is, unemployment rate for urban women is quite higher than rural areas. So that is kind of this, that not a lot of women in India, urban India, are finding gainful employment. They are dropping out of employment because of the conditions, or you know, what are the motivation. Then you actually go for deeper, you know, you kind of go into figuring out why is this happening. Then that is something that, you know, it again starts deconstructing a lot of concepts that you earlier thought you knew. Then you actually go into the thing, oh, why are women dropping out? We actually did a 10-part series just about this, trying to figure out what is it that actually leads to women in urban India falling out of the workforce. Some of them cannot, you know, be it the family system, that women's work is seen as secondary, that it's only there to supplement the family income, and things like that. All these attitudes kind of come around, you know, figuring out there are safety concerns are an issue, your public transports are an issue. It, as I said, you know, it breaks down a lot of stereotypes that you have in your head. So that's why it's always a healthy practice to have data in your story.
Excellent there, Prachi. Excellent.
Thank you.
Does anybody have any more questions? Final call before we sign off. And before I give a final concluding remark, just how beautiful and wonderful this session was for us as well, because it was intellectually very stimulating and professionally very focused. And I'm sure that students might have had some takeaways from your talk. And of course, they can connect with you now that you are in the loop, and sort of and we would like to, you know, welcome you in our college when the lockdown is lifted and you happen to visit Delhi. So, but we can only hope for that situation, which seems very unlikely as of now. But just to, you know, conclude by this phrase that what you said, that that there is a Grand Canyon which divides mainstream media and alternative media, I think it would be something, it would be kind of a phrase that you would be coining. I think it's for us academics as well as for you professionals to sort of, you know, further problematize this, you know, the highlighting of Grand Canyon that you have just, you know, outlined. I think we would just, you know, maybe work on it, you know, at the intersections of new media and mainstream media. And of course, duly, you know, attribute this thought to you maybe. So I have noted it down in my notebook. That was one thing. And the second thing was how actually your work seeks to sort of humanize the mass of information and knowledge which is there. So I think media is right now in the crisis globally because the convergence hypothesis of the Anglo-American journalistic practice is actually seeing that crisis. It's in the middle of that crisis. And I can see that what can just survive the media and the profession is if you are able to humanize information and knowledge, which was, this is just a supplement to what you have been saying about how you, you know, use data and how you translate those data into, you know, humanistic stories, you know, try to give it a human face. I think that would be the major upshot of this talk, and students would must, you know, note that in their own diaries and something to, you know, look up to when they, you know, enter profession and actually emulate you and, you know, people like you out there in the field. We still have this much of hope, and we can only appreciate and emulate your work and, you know, keep our constant engagement with you. Thank you so much. It was really informative, educative, and entertaining as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you indeed.
Thank you.